Now next is simple pendulum. Now we have to know the physics behind simple pendulum, because by using the simple pendulum we can measure the time. That's why we have to learn about it. So what is a simple pendulum? Simple pendulum is a heavy mass suspended from a rigid support. This support is rigid. Just try to understand the points, important points. This is a rigid support and this is a heavy mass, and it is suspended by a massless inextensible string. Inextensible means what? When you are putting suspending the mass, then generally what happens? That it gets elongated, the string. So in this case we are considering that it is not getting elongated. So it is the definition of an ideal simple pendulum. Alright, so what is a simple pendulum? What is it? A heavy mass suspended from a rigid support by a massless and inextensible string. Now, when you are considering the simple pendulum like this, this is known as the pendulum bob, and the center of the bob is known as the center of the bob. It is the center of gravity of the pendulum, and this is known as the mean position. This position of the pendulum, it is known as the mean position. Now what we generally do, just you understand it, we take it here, alright, and then we just release it. And when we release it, then what it does? It just have a to and fro motion. Alright, so if I draw the diagram, then you may consider that the pendulum, it is coming from B to A. And then it will come to C. From B it will come to A, then again it will go to C, again it will come back to A to B. So this is the way it will have a to and fro motion, which is known as oscillation. And this kind of motion of the pendulum is also known as simple harmonic motion. Now, so what is simple pendulum and what kind of oscillation it has? I hope everybody has understood. Now, there are few terms associated with the pendulum. So, one by one, I am just explaining them. First one is, what is the effective length of a pendulum? The first term is, what is effective length of a pendulum? Understand it. Effective length of a pendulum is the distance between the point of suspension and center of gravity of the bob. So you must note it down. I am not writing it, I am saying it verbally. So everybody should know down what is the definition of effective length. What I said, distance between the point of suspension and center of gravity of the bob. So if I just draw it in the diagram, then you see this is the effective length of the pendulum. So here you can nicely relate it to the length of the string used. So let us consider that length of the string is this, it is L, and the radius, this is radius of the bob. Radius of the bob is R. Then what is the effective length of the pendulum? Length of the string plus radius of the bob. So this is the concept of effective length. Then second is amplitude of the pendulum. What is amplitude? Amplitude is the maximum displacement of the bob on either side of the main position is known as the amplitude. What is amplitude? I said the maximum displacement of the pendulum from the main position on either side is known as the amplitude. Then next one is one complete oscillation. This is also a very important concept. You have to understand that. What is one complete oscillation? One complete oscillation means one complete to and fro motion is known as one complete oscillation. So you see, if the pendulum starts from C, okay, then what is one complete oscillation? It will be C, then A, then B, then A, then C. You see, it is starting from C, going to A to B, and then again coming back to C. So this is one complete oscillation. But when it is starting from A, suppose it has started from A to this side. In that case, one complete oscillation, we say it this way, that it will start oscillation, start moving in one direction from one position until and unless it returns to the same position and start moving in the same direction, we say it as a complete oscillation. Just consider the example. Suppose the pendulum has started from A initially and moving in this direction. So it is going from A to B. Then you see again it is coming back to A. So do you think that it is a complete oscillation? It has started from A in this direction. It has gone to B. Then it has come back to A. Is it a complete oscillation? It has come back to the same position. But we do not consider it as a complete oscillation. Why? You see here, after starting from A, it was moving in this direction. It has gone to B. It has gone to A. Now it is moving in this direction. So is it moving in the same direction as it was at the starting point? No. So you cannot say that ABA is the complete oscillation. But if you consider this, that it has gone from A to B, then it has come to A, then again it has gone to C, and then it has come back to A, then you see what is happening, A to B to A, C to A, then it is about to start in the same direction. So you can say that this is a complete oscillation. The next topic is time period. Time period, generally we denote it by big T. What is time period? Time needed for one complete oscillation. So what is the SI unit of time period? SI unit of time period is second. Then next topic is frequency. Next term is frequency. How we define frequency? Frequency is number of complete oscillation in 1 second is known as frequency. What is frequency? The total number of complete oscillation in 1 second is known as frequency. And what is the SI unit of frequency? Everybody knows SI unit of frequency is hertz. Alright. Now there is a nice relation between time period and frequency. Understand it. If you consider time period is T second, then you see in T second, how many number of complete oscillation will be how much? Number of complete oscillation is equal to 1. Isn't it? That is the definition of time period. Time needed for one complete oscillation. So if time period is T second, what you can write? In T second, number of complete oscillation is 1. So in 1 second, number of complete oscillation will be how much? 1 upon T. Now we know number of complete oscillation in 1 second is nothing but frequency. So what one can write? Frequency is equal to 1 upon time period. And SI unit of frequency is hertz. Next is factors on which time period, I have used the abbreviation, time period depends. Alright. Time period depends on effective length. This is also known as law of length. Alright. How does it depend? Time period is directly proportional to the square root of effective length. You can write it symbolically also. You can write it in sentence also. So law of length is time period directly proportional to square of the effective length. Then second is time period depends on acceleration due to gravity small g. So that is known as the law of gravity. That is, we say it time period directly, sorry, time period is inversely proportional to square root of acceleration due to gravity. What does this g represent? This is acceleration due to gravity. Alright. So T is inversely proportional to square root of g. As it is inversely proportional, that's why I have written 1 upon root g. Proportional to 1 upon root g. So if you combine this two, what you are getting? T is proportional to under root L by G. So proportional sign, when you replace by an equal sign, then you know you have to introduce here one constant of proportionality. So this constant of proportionality is found experimentally. It is 2 pi. Alright, I hope everybody knows about this pi. Pi is 22 by 7 or, okay, you can write 22 by 7 only. So time period is 2 pi under root L by G. So this is the formula for time period of a simple pendulum. Time period of a simple pendulum is given by 2 pi under root L by G. Next is Time period does not depend on mass of the bob provided the effective length remains the same. Means this is also known as law of mass. So what I said, law of mass, I'm saying it verbally, I'm not writing it, it will take time. Please you note it down. Okay, time period of a simple pendulum does not depend on the mass of the bob if the effective length remains the same. Just to understand it, what is the meaning? Because this point is very important concept wise. Suppose you have taken a pendulum like this. This is the bob. Mass of the bob is, now mass of the bob is small. Now you have taken a very big and heavy bob. But you have taken the big bob in such a manner, you see here, you see the bob, how I have taken. It is very big, heavy, but the center of gravity remains the same. So you see the effective length, it is same. Got it? Then time period does not depend on mass of the bob. Understood what I said? But if you do this, that you have taken a heavy bob and you have not changed the length of the string, means you are doing like this. Then you see, now suppose you have taken the bob in such a way that you see center of gravity is here. So it is increasing the effective length. Is the effective length for this one and this one is same? No. So here what will happen? As effective length changes, time period will change. So that's why time period does not depend on mass of the bob if the effective length remains the same. Alright, then the fourth one is that time period does not depend on the amplitude of oscillation. Clear? In this case also there is a restriction that oscillation, amplitude of oscillation, angular oscillation, it should be, angular amplitude, it should be less than 4 degrees. Then only it is possible. Otherwise what will happen? The motion will not remain linear. That's why this restriction is there. So, in general, we say that time period does not depend on amplitude of the bob, but provided that amplitude remains very small. Now, we know that time period is 2 pi under root L by G. So, you see, if you square it, both the sides, what it will become? T square is equal to 4 pi square by G into L. This is the relation you must remember. This is an important relation. Important for the next discussion. Next one is, graphically we have to, means the graph related with the simple pendulum. So you know that, I hope all of you are having the basic concept you have learnt in maths. What is graph, what is x axis, what is y axis, how we plot a point, what are the coordinates of a point. All these things, I hope you have the concept. So I am considering that you have concept of graph and then I am discussing this topic. Alright, so how we plot a graph? Generally, what we do, we draw a horizontal line, we consider it as x-axis, and the vertical line, we consider it as y-axis. And the two axes meeting at the point that we consider as the origin. I hope you are having this concept. And what is the thumb rule of plotting a graph? Whenever a graph is plotted, we always consider that y is function of x. Means, always, two quantities when we plot along y and along x axis, then along x axis, we plot the independent quantity and we plot the dependent quantity on y axis. I repeat, we plot the independent quantity along x-axis and we plot the dependent quantity along y-axis. Alright, now if we consider this relation that t square is equal to 4 pi square by g into l. So suppose I want to plot t square versus l graph. What we want to do? We want to plot t square versus l graph. Then you see effective length, it is a independent quantity. So length should be plotted along the x-axis and t square should be plotted along y-axis. I repeat that t square versus l graph when you plot, t square should be plotted along y-axis, l should be plotted along x-axis. Now here you see t square is equal to 4 pi square by g into l. So when you plot the graph will be a straight line passing through the origin. I have not drawing it, it will be a straight line passing through the origin. All right. Then the next cause. So T square versus L graph. What is the nature of T square versus L graph? Very important question for your board exam. What is the nature of the T square versus L graph? It is a straight line passing through the origin. Now you see, one can plot this also. You see, T is 2 pi root g then into root L. So if you plot T versus root L graph, T versus root L graph, then also it will be a straight line passing through the origin. But if you plot T versus L graph, if you plot a T versus L graph, then it will be a curve. All right. So you must learn all the three graphs, nature of all the three graphs. T square versus L graph is a straight line passing through origin. T versus root L graph is a straight line passing through origin. Whereas T versus L graph, it is a curve. It is not a straight line. You must remember it. Now, T square versus L graph is a straight line passing through the origin. Now, from the slope of a graph, slope of a T square versus L graph, one can find out what is the acceleration due to gravity. So, I hope you have the concept of slope of a graph. What is slope of a graph? Slope of a graph, we define it in this way. Change of the quantity plotted along y axis divided by change of the quantity plotted along x axis. Alright. So, here you see what we have plotted along y axis. We have plotted T square. So, you can write it as it will be change in T square. Delta means change. And then what will be the quantity plotted along x axis? This is length. Alright. Now, look at this relation. T square by L is equal to how much? It is coming 4 pi square by g, isn't it? So you see, what is the slope of the T square versus L graph? It is 4 pi square by g. Is that clear? So you see, one can find out g this way. G is equal to 4 pi square divided by slope of T square versus L graph. This one, once again, we will do it in the practical class. Alright, that g is equal to 4 pi square by slope of T square versus L graph. And this formula, at least you remember, because we need it to solve the numericals. Now, this chapter, measurement and experimentation chapter, is over. But I have not discussed vernier caliper and screw gauge because I want to show you the apparatus. And that's why after reopening, when we'll meet again, then I will discuss vernier caliper and screw gauge. But you do one thing, leaving that two topic, whatever I have discussed so far, you write it down properly in your study material notebook. Thank you, girls.